We are back now with more Commitment 2012 coverage. Today we're talking with the candidates in the race for the 41st State House District. The district covers East Hempfield Township, part of East Petersburg Borough, and parts of Lancaster and Manor Townships. Republican Ryan Aument is seeking his second term, and he is being challenged in this election by Democrat Marcy Dubroff, an associate director of the POGL Project, a professional development organization that uses a different method to teach math and science. She also has a background in higher education. And we welcome you both here today, and thanks for talking with us. Marcy, you have said you don't agree with some of Representative Aument's votes, particularly voter ID. What else can you do you not agree with?
Representative Aument co-sponsored the ultrasound bill, HB 1077, which would have forced a woman who was seeking an abortion to undergo an ultrasound. And that was really a tipping point for me to get into the race. I really thought that that was an invasion of privacy. It's a decision that a woman needs to make with her physician, and I don't think that the government needs to get involved in those sorts of things. And that was really one of the biggest issues for me getting into the race.
It was a very controversial proposal. Mm-hmm. Why did you propose that?
Well, I didn't propose it. I was an early co-sponsor. It was actually Representative Kathy Rapp, who is the prime sponsor of that legislation. And I co-sponsored it because I believe that a woman has a right to know, has the right to access all of her medical information. It's very clear that Planned Parenthood and the National Abortion Federation already have it as their standard procedure to conduct these ultrasounds, to know the position of the baby, the health of the woman. And I'm not aware of any other medical procedure in which all of that information isn't made accessible to the woman. So really it came down to me is ensuring openness and transparency and that women have access to this information.
And my understanding, this would have been a mandatory ultrasound, or is that not correct?
The ultrasound would have been mandatory. The woman would have had the option in terms of the information presented, whether she would view the ultrasound. Right.
As the governor said some time ago, she didn't have to look at it.
She didn't have to look at it. And again, I just don't think that the government has the right to tell a woman what she can and cannot do with her body under any circumstances.
All right. Well, on to economic issues. The unemployment rate in Pennsylvania is above the national average now, which is 7.8%. Pennsylvania's latest figures, 8.2%. How do we change that? What do we have to do about that, Representative Aument?
Well, I think part of the answer, frankly, is a change of administration in Washington. I think we've worked very hard in Harrisburg to turn the economic corner after 8 years of spending, reckless spending, borrowing, accounting gimmicks to increase spending and really put Pennsylvania on a path to an economic crisis. When we entered office 2 years ago, Governor Corbett and this Republican legislature, the first challenge we had to face was closing a $4 billion budget deficit and to rein in public spending so that we could position position the Commonwealth for private sector economic growth so that we could create jobs and opportunity. I think we're well on that path in Pennsylvania. We have obviously tremendous challenges in the future in terms of looming pension crisis, transportation funding, but I believe because of a responsible budget that we've passed these last 2 years that we've positioned the Commonwealth for economic growth. So, frankly, we also need some help with the federal government, and so I'm looking forward to a change there potentially.
And what about you, Marcy, in terms of the unemployment rate?
I think we need to change the culture where we reward big businesses with tax cuts. I think the key to creating jobs and increasing employment is to focus on creating sustainable jobs at the local level, making it easier for small businesses to hire people to create jobs. Right now, big businesses like Shell are getting that $1.5 billion tax cut. Corporations in the Marcellus Shale area are not paying their fair amount for drilling in that region. We need to say to those people, yes, you have to pay your fair share of taxes, close the Delaware loophole, and make it easier for the small businesses to create jobs. If every small business in Lancaster County was on the average able to hire just one person, we would almost eradicate unemployment. And the key is keeping it in our communities, keeping it local, because that's where the growth happens.
You mentioned Governor Corbett's budget several times. What about funding for education, for public education? There's been lots of talk about reforming property taxes, and that shouldn't be the way to go. What's your reaction to that?
Well, I think reforming property taxes is a good idea. I've heard that when I've gone door to door. I don't think that the property tax is the appropriate way to fund education. I think that we need to look at different methods to do that. I think, first of all, we need to restore some of the cuts that Governor Corbett put into place. I also think that we need to look at a system where we are instituting maybe a little bit higher sales tax, a little bit higher personal income tax, but property tax, it's actually a very old tax historically. It was instituted a couple hundred years ago, I think, back in the day when it actually was meant to do something else. And I think if we take property tax and we use it for government expenditures at the local level and really make it something that that it was designed to do and not funding public education, that would be a good thing. To fund education, there is money out there. Like I said, I think that the Marcellus Shale region, if we could get the money from the drillers that we're supposed to, that we've left money on the table in the Marcellus Shale region, that money could be pumped back in.
All right, well, let's get to education funding.
Well, first, to the property tax. I've been the leader on that issue. In the 2 years that I've been in Harrisburg, I've co-sponsored legislation to eliminate school property taxes, to transition to a sales tax and to an income tax and move away from the property tax, because I agree, it's not a sustainable model for funding public education. So I've been a leader on that issue. We've got work to do on that. I look forward to taking that on next legislative session. I think when you look at education funding, I think it's important for residents to recall that when we assumed office 2 years ago, that we inherited a budget in which Governor Rendell and Democratic House had had added to education funding through the use of federal stimulus dollars, essentially cut state funding for education, and then backfilled using not permanent but temporary federal stimulus dollars that everyone knew was going to be temporary. And so we had to make some very difficult decisions. I cast votes and encouraged and pushed the governor to increase spending. I shouldn't say not me alone, but us as a Republican caucus in the House restored some of the funding cuts that the governor initially proposed. We've got to do some things in terms of reducing spending, the unfunded mandates. I also think we need to make sure that we are more efficiently spending those dollars in terms of the distribution from the state to the local school districts. Growing school districts like Hempfield and Penn Manor are not fairly compensated. I think there's more that we can do there. I think there's other ways in which we can improve education. I was a prime sponsor of the educator evaluation bill that the governor signed as a freshman member. I was pleased to be able to work on that legislation, which I think is one of the more groundbreaking education reform items in recent years. And so
right.
I think that'll have a dramatic effect on
just quickly, Marcy, you said you would like to see some of the cuts that Governor Corcoran made restored to the budget, such as?
Well, the cuts that were passed along essentially to the local districts, we're down about 18,000 teachers across the board, whether they're positions that haven't been filled or just been eliminated. We've seen librarians cut out of schools. We've seen foreign language programs reduced. We've seen arts and sports and music cut. These are not luxuries at the public school level. They are necessities. I think it is our duty as a Commonwealth to provide an excellent, outstanding public education to every student that chooses to get one. And I would like to see those kinds of programs restored. I love the fact that you proposed a teacher assessment system, but quite frankly, that's not what's needed right now. I think the problem is not assessing our teachers. It's getting money back into the classrooms to use for the children, for technology, for modernizing our schools, for reducing class sizes, for letting teachers teach and be innovative in the classroom.
All right, very good. Well, thank you both for joining us today. We appreciate it and for informing our viewers and your constituents. Thanks again. And we'll be right back.